Dear students, welcome to the second module of Metallurgy in Science and Technology Part 1. In the previous module, we have learned about the physical properties of metals and nonmetals as well as the flame test for metals. In this module, we will be learning more about the chemical properties of metals, such as metals' reaction with oxygen, its reaction with water, with dilute acids, and reactivity series of metals, as well as metals reacting with non-metals. The first property we are going to see is how metals are reacting with oxygen. So we know that metals react with oxygen to form metal oxide. Sodium metal is the one highly reactive. Both sodium and potassium are highly reactive with oxygen. Sodium combines with oxygen in air even at room temperature and it forms the metal oxide, that is sodium oxide. So on exposure to air, we know that sodium readily catches fire. So to prevent the accident in labs or somewhere else, sodium and potassium are always preserved in kerosene. So here is the chemical reaction. Sodium reacts with oxygen to form sodium oxide. So if you see the metal oxides reacts with water. They are soluble in water. They react with water to form an alkali. So this is the famous alkali sodium hydroxide. Similarly, magnesium oxide is also formed when you burn magnesium ribbon in air. This magnesium oxide also reacts with water to form the alkali magnesium hydroxide. So this is the chemical reaction. Magnesium reacts with oxygen to form magnesium oxide. The magnesium oxide dissolves in water to form the alkali magnesium hydroxide. The next we are going to see reaction of metals with water. As usual, sodium and potassium, which are highly reactive, they react rapidly and vigorously with water and liberate hydrogen gas. If you see the chemical reaction, sodium reacts with water to form sodium hydroxide in aqueous state with the liberation of hydrogen gas and heat. The same with potassium as well. Potassium reacts with water to form the alkali potassium hydroxide with the liberation of hydrogen gas and heat. The next metal, calcium, it reacts with water slowly and less vigorously. Hydrogen gas is released in this case also. The released hydrogen gas collects on the surface of the metal in the form of bubbles. So the metal floats on water. Calcium reacts with water to form calcium hydroxide in the aqueous state with liberation of hydrogen gas. The next, if you see, metals like aluminium, iron and zinc, they do not react with cold water or hot water, but they react with steam to form their corresponding oxide. In this case also, hydrogen gas is released. If you see the experimental setup, you can see the test tube, a bigger test tube fitted with a cork, and then there is a glass wool soaked in water which will be heated up with the help of burner. The water will evaporate and release steam and react with the metal sample that is there in the test tube. So after reacting with the metal sample, the hydrogen gas is liberated. The liberated hydrogen gas is collected via the bent tube and you can see the hydrogen gas being collected in the inverted test tube kept in the water. This is the experimental setup. If you see the reaction of aluminium, iron and zinc with water, they form their corresponding oxides with the liberation of hydrogen gas. So with increase in the strength of the metal, I can say, or in the reactive ability of the element, The elements, that is the metals, choose to react with normal cold water or hot water or steam. Now we are going to see reaction of metals with dilute acid. Metals like aluminium, magnesium, iron or zinc, they react with dilute sulfuric acid or hydrochloric acid to form sulfate or chloride salts of metals. In this case also, hydrogen gas is liberated. If you see the reactivity of metals, that is which metal is highly reactive among all four, magnesium is the one which is highly reactive, then comes aluminium, and then third place is zinc, and then iron. This is a comparison between only these four metals. We are not including any other metal. So among these four, magnesium is the highly reactive, where iron is the least reactive. If you see the experimental setup, usually we will take a big boiling tube. This test tube is called a boiling tube, mounted on a stand. The boiling tube consists of dilute hydrochloric acid, in this case with zinc granules. The hydrochloric acid react with the zinc granules, and you can see the bubbles of hydrogen gas coming out. The hydrogen gas is liberated and then collected via the delivery tube fitted with the cork in the boiling test tube. This liberated hydrogen gas is made to pass via a soap solution, which forms soap bubbles. If you are keeping a burning candle or a matchstick near the soap bubble that contains hydrogen gas, you can see it burning with a cracking noise. This cracking noise gives you, this is a test to know that the liberated gas is hydrogen gas. So this, instead of zinc, you can use any of the metals, and we can find the same reaction, that is same liberation of hydrogen gas taking place. If we see the chemical reaction, magnesium reacts with hydrochloric acid to form magnesium chloride and liberates hydrogen gas. Aluminium reacts with hydrochloric acid to form aluminium chloride and hydrogen gas is liberated. Iron reacts with hydrochloric acid to form iron chloride. This is called ferrous chloride, with hydrogen gas being liberated. The same reaction you can see for zinc as well. Zinc reacts with hydrochloric acid to form zinc chloride, and hydrogen gas is liberated. In all the cases when metals react with acid, hydrogen gas is liberated along with the formation of corresponding salts of metals. Now we are going to see the reaction of metals with nitric acid. Metals react with nitric acid to form the corresponding nitrate salts of metals. Along with the nitrate salt, oxides of nitrogen like N2O, which is nothing but nitrous oxide, are otherwise called as laughing gas, and NO, which is nitric acid, NO2, nitrogen dioxide, are also formed along with the nitrate salt. So the formation of this oxide depend upon the concentration of nitric acid used. If you see the chemical reaction, we are taking copper metal here, and we are using concentrated nitric acid in one case and dilute nitric acid in the other. If we are using concentrated nitric acid, the products that we are getting are copper nitrate. This copper nitrate is common for both the cases. And if you see the oxides of nitrogen, the first case, that is with concentrated nitric acid, we are getting nitrogen dioxide as a product. And in the second case, that is while we are using dilute nitric acid, we are getting nitric oxide as the product along with water. Now we are going to see about a famous reagent called aqua regia. We'll see what it is. Aqua regia is a highly corrosive and fuming liquid. If you see the image, we are first adding, you can see a piece of gold lying at the bottom. We have added 10 ml of hydrochloric acid first. Now 1 ml of nitric acid is also being added. You can see after the addition of nitric acid, strong bubbles start to form from gold, which means that we can clearly see that the gold is reacting with this reagent. This reagent is used to dissolve noble metals like gold and platinum. Aqua regia is always freshly prepared and the concentration of hydrochloric acid is 3 parts with nitric acid 1 part. It have high industrial application to dissolve noble metals like gold and platinum especially. Now, the reaction of metals with salts of other metals is what we are going to see. We are going to do an activity and see what is going to happen. The apparatus required are copper wire, we need an iron nail, beakers, big test tubes, etc. And the chemicals needed are aqueous solutions of ferrous sulfate and copper sulfate. So how we are going to do? First, we are going to take a clean copper wire and a clean iron nail and we are going to dip the copper wire in ferrous sulfate solution and iron nail in copper sulfate solution. We are going to keep on observing continuously at fixed intervals of time what reaction is happening in the test tubes. First, you can see in the apparatus, there are two test tubes you are clearly seeing. The first test tube, which has a blue color solution because the salt copper sulfate has a natural blue color and the aqueous solution of copper sulfate gives you this blue color, and we are seeing iron nail being dipped with the help of a thread and the test tube is closed with the help of a cork. The second test tube contains the aqueous solution of ferrous sulfate, which will be slight green in color. And we are seeing a copper wire being dipped in the ferrous sulfate solution with the help of a thread, which is again closed with the help of the cork. After some time, we are going to observe any changes that is happening either in the solution or in the iron nail or copper wire. After some time, if you observe the test tubes, in which test tube the reaction has taken place, the reaction would have been taken place in the test tube that contains iron nail in copper sulfate solution. So how we will recognize that a reaction has taken place? The blue color solution of copper sulfate would have turned colorless. So what is this type of reaction? If you see, the iron displaced copper from the copper sulfate solution. So this is a displacement reaction. If you see the chemical equation, iron nail reacts with copper sulfate. If you see, the copper is getting displaced by iron so that ferrous sulfate solution along with copper metal is formed. So with this we will find that the reaction has taken place with iron nail and copper sulfate solution, but we do not see any changes with copper in ferrous sulfate solution. Through the experiment, we have seen that some metal displace the other metal when reacting with their corresponding salt solution. So the displacement reaction of metals with the solution of salts of other metals, it is helpful to determine which metal is highly reactive and which is the low reactive one. If a metal A displaces another metal B from the solution of its salt, it means that the metal A is more reactive than the metal B. So using this, scientists have developed a reactivity series by doing many experiments of this displacement reaction. So based on this, the arrangement of metals are made either in increasing or decreasing order of reactivity. And this arrangement is called reactivity series of metals. So using this, metals are divided into following groups. So that is, they are divided as highly reactive, moderately reactive, or less reactive metals. So this is the reactivity series of the metals. If you see, they are named here, and then the reaction is either they are highly reactive or less reactive is also indicated. If you see, many metals, almost many of the metals react with oxygen, but few metals react with acid, and very few react with water. The reactivity of the metal depends upon its ability, that is its ability to react. That is, that makes some metals like sodium, potassium, lithium, calcium, those are high reactive metals. Magnesium, aluminium, zinc, iron, tin and lead on the other hand are moderately reactive metals. Copper, mercury, silver and gold are less reactive metal. This helps us to understand whether a particular metal can be used for a particular purpose or not. This reactivity series helps to understand the ability of a metal to react at certain conditions. Now we will see how metals react with non-metals. So we know that whenever an element is undergoing any chemical reaction, it is because it does want to attain the electronic configuration of the nearest noble gas. If you take metals, the metals attain this configuration by losing their electron. The same way, when you take non-metals, again, they by gaining electron, they will try to attain the electronic configuration of the nearest noble gas. For example, you take the formation of sodium chloride. Sodium chloride is formed by sodium metal giving away one electron to the non-metal chlorine. Here the metal sodium loses an electron and the element, that is a non-metal chlorine, gains an electron, and this losing and gaining gives them charges, that is sodium attains a positive charge where chlorine attains a negative charge, and this brings a electrostatic attraction between them and they stay as a sodium chloride salt. If you see the chemical reaction, sodium metal reacts with the non-metal to form sodium chloride. This compound formed, or this salt, is called as an ionic compound due to the formation of ions in this reaction. The same way, metals like magnesium and potassium also form the ionic compounds, magnesium chloride and potassium chloride, in the same way. Let us summarize what we have learned in this module. We have learned that metals react with oxygen to form corresponding metal oxide. With water, metals form oxides with the liberation of hydrogen gas. Metals react with the dilute sulfuric or hydrochloric acid to form sulfate or chloride salt along with the liberation of hydrogen gas. The nitrate salts are formed on reaction of metals with nitric acid. The arrangement of metals in increasing or decreasing order of reactivity is called as reactivity series of metals. Also, we have learned that metals react with non-metals to form ionic compounds. In the coming modules, we will be learning about the chemical properties of non-metals and about ionic compounds in detail. Until then, thank you for listening, children.